interesting. Alex is a CETA National Fellow who is out of UBC, but he comes to Toronto from Japan, I would say. We've all really enjoyed talking with him this week about various things. So Alex is an expert in the growth of nonlinear structures in the universe. His model is used by a lot of people for understanding the nonlinear power spectrum, which is, I think, what he'll talk about, part of what he'll talk about today. His PhD is from Edinburgh, where he worked with John Peacock, and now he's out at UBC working especially with the Weak Lensing group out there. Also is involved in data analysis in the theory where he's working on with the CFHT lensing data. So we'll talk about some theory stuff, I think, today, so take it away, Alex.
Cool. Okay, well, thank you. I'm going to talk about the spherical collapse model in cosmology, which at least some of you are familiar with, I think. So if not, I'll talk about what that is and define that, and I'll also define what I mean by useful in the context of this question, and then that'll be the end of that. So by way of introduction, I'm going to talk mainly to give this some context. The main application that I can think of for this is weak gravitational lensing. So that's some way using the distortions of shapes of galaxies to measure the intervening matter distribution. And because this is a kind of comparatively low redshift compared with a lot of other cosmological probes, maybe you're getting signal from around redshift a half or redshift one, and it's on comparatively small scales, you need to worry about the nonlinear clustering of matter in order to interpret your data. And that's the sort of the relevance of what I'm going to talk about today. So I'm going to talk about the spherical collapse model and particularly how it changes as a function of the background cosmological model. I'm going to then see to what extent we can test these changes of the spherical collapse model as the background cosmology changes. And because this is a model that relates to halos, your initial guess might be we need to test this by looking at halos and halo properties. But I'm going to sort of talk about why that's kind of difficult to do, because halos are kind of hard objects to define in sort of a precise way. And I'm going to sort of present an argument why I think a better way of testing the cosmology dependence of these parameters is just via the power spectrum of the full matter field, so that you don't have to worry about defining or finding halos particularly. I'm then going to present some results for the power spectrum, for the nonlinear power spectrum of some dark energy models and some modified gravity models. So weak gravitational lensing. So there are surveys such as KID, DES, Euclid, LSST, WFIRST, probably others that I've forgotten. And I guess one of the primary aims of these things is to measure the properties of dark energy. And they sort of take advantage of this low redshift nature of weak gravitational lensing that I described, because dark energy is most active at low redshifts. So you measure basically the matter distribution at low redshifts using these things, and dark energy will change that. So for example, it might make perturbations grow more quickly or more slowly. And therefore, we can learn about dark energy by doing this weak lensing. And as I said before, it gets most of its power from these kind of smallish scales. So I'm going to say around K of 1. And if you think about what that translates to in terms of physical things, it's kind of like 2 pi over 1. So the physical scale that corresponds to is the typical distance between clusters, say, or between. So these kind of quite nonlinear scales, which is why we need to worry about this. We're not just thinking about linear perturbation theory here. Kind of obviously precise measurements from lensing, and people talk about measuring the dark energy equation of state to 1%, require you to know your theory equally precisely. So you need to know the nonlinear matter power spectrum for any different dark energy model you hope weak lensing can tell you anything about to 1% accuracy. And I know the number for Euclid that gets thrown around at the moment is you need 1% accuracy to K of 5 in order to interpret Euclid correctly. And there are sort of several different ways of getting the nonlinear power that people use at the moment. One is something called halo fit. So you might have heard of this as like the Smith et al. Or the Takahashi et al. Method, which is a fitting function. And that, as a function of cosmology, is about accurate at the 10% level on the type of scales that are relevant to weak lensing. Slightly more accurate is an approach I worked on before called HM code, which is slightly more accurate. And I would say better. Obviously, I'm biased. But it is physically motivated. And so, in principle, you can understand the dependence of the matter power spectrum on what's going on a little bit better using this method. And it's also possible to extend it to new cosmological ideas more easily. Finally, there are these things called emulators to get the nonlinear matter power spectrum. And what's going on there is that people have run lots of cosmological simulations at different points in cosmological parameter space, and then do some clever way of interpolating between these things. And if you run enough simulations and if you fill your parameter cube of cosmological parameters that you care about densely enough, then this interpolation can be quite accurate. And so these methods are claimed to be about 1% accurate. So clearly improved greatly over this kind of fitting function and this Hayler model-based approach. But the big disadvantage of these approaches is they're difficult to extend to new parameters, because as soon as you add some other thing in, so for example, there's something called the Kyoto universe, which varies sigma 8, H, omega matter, omega baryon, W in the spectral index. But as soon as you want to, say, start worrying about time-varying dark energy or massive neutrinos, you can't just like tag on a new parameter, because that parameter space is not filled at all by the cube that you use to do this. So weak lensing, here are some galaxies, and now if I put some matter between us and those galaxies, you see something like this. So you can kind of infer properties of the intervening matter by looking at correlations in the shape distortions. That's all you need to know about weak lensing for the purposes of this. And as I said before, dark energy can be measured because it affects what's going on here. Okay. So the spherical collapse model. So what's that? And the idea here is to consider a featureless universe, or almost featureless universe, that contains just one spherical perturbation in it, and because of the symmetry, we can solve for the overdensity, that's delta, which I'm going to write here in case anybody forgets. So that's just 1 plus delta is just the density at some position divided by the mean density at that time. So we can solve, because of the symmetry, you can do like a Newtonian calculation of this. You put down this sphere, you put like a test particle on the edge of it, and you say how does the radius of that test particle vary as it expands? So, so you can write down this, you can do that thing, write down this differential equation for the overdensity, which is that, which is kind of like what you'd expect. It's a second order differential equation in this delta parameter. Right, and the first thing I guess you notice about this is that there are linear terms in this equation and nonlinear terms. So I've highlighted in red here the nonlinear contributions. And so if you linearize this equation, you consider only small values of delta and small time derivatives of delta, you end up with this equation, which I think many of you, if you're sort of into cosmology, will recognize. This is the standard equation for the linear evolution of perturbations in a sub-horizon limit. Right, so this has kind of famous solution that for an Einstein de Sitter universe, that is a universe where omega matter is one and there's no dark energy or anything like that, that delta grows with the scale factor. So if as the universe doubles in size, right, A goes from 0.5 to 1, linear perturbations double in amplitude, double in height, right? Okay, is everyone happy with this? No one, you should interrupt me if I say anything you think is wrong or not clear.
Can I ask you a question about the previous thing you showed, the distortion of the cartoon? The so when you lens them, the shapes change, but also the positions for objects change.
Yes.
Do you know the status of trying to use the change in the positions of the objects due to lensing to try and extract the lensing signal?
Yeah, I don't know about the status. I know that's something. If you knew the initial positions, you'd be like laughing, because this is a huge signal compared to the shape distortions. But I'm absolutely not an expert in that at all. Okay. Right, so I'm just going to show you, so one thing you can then do is we've got these two equations. We've got an equation for the nonlinear, the full correct equation for the nonlinear evolution of this spherical top hat and this linear equation. Now, if we evolve them in tandem, we see something like this. So this is going to be in physical coordinates rather than co-moving coordinates. And initially, we've got like our little perturbation at the center there, and there are going to be two coming out. And you see the linear one is the one at the outside that sort of expands forever. That's delta proportional to A, and it goes on and on But the real perturbation eventually reaches some maximum size. Its gravity then kind of forces it to turn around and it collapses. And this is exactly the same maths as a closed universe, right? If you have a closed matter-dominated universe, the solution is the same and you can write it down analytically. So in this calculation, because of the symmetry, if you figure out exactly what goes on, actually the perturbation height becomes infinite at some point, and that's a result of not having anything to stop that. So if you took this literally, you might imagine this thing collapses to a black hole or something like that, which is what I'm showing here. So here's A, the scale factor along the bottom, and in the top panel you've got delta on the y-axis, and in the bottom panel some measure of the radius of this thing. So in terms of the overdensity, that you can see the linear and the what I've called the top hat here solution initially grow in tandem, and then as time passes they start to depart from one another, and finally and kind of very quickly at the end here the full nonlinear solution collapses to this infinite density, the radius drops to zero. And one kind of famous result in nonlinear structure formation is that the value the linear density field takes when the nonlinear density field has reached infinity is 1.686. It's this weird number. That number's independent of the mass of the perturbation. It's independent of the initial radius or whatever. So it's for anything, and it's kind of like a well-known number to some people. Now, of course, we don't believe the universe actually contains these spherical structures, and realistic perturbations will have some, A, they won't be spherical, and B, they'll contain anisotropy, and they'll be influenced by the sort of tidal field of what's around them. So what we can think is, rather than this thing collapsing to be some black hole or something, it eventually sort of mixes up, and we think that the virial theorem will apply. So at the end, you have something like the kinetic energy of that system will be about half, well, negative half of the potential energy. And from this, you can calculate, have a guess, kind of calculate a guess for what the radius of that collapsed structure will be. So what we can do is say, well, we believe the structure will have formed at the time that this nonlinear solution's gone to infinity, but we say at that point, well, we don't believe it's infinite, it's got a radius of zero. We'll say it's got a radius given by the virial theorem, and you can solve this quite straightforwardly, and then that gives you a density because you've got a time in the universe and you've got a radius, so you can compute its overdensity. So you have this idea that a sphere that's collapsed, this is collapsing at some redshift, should be about 178 times denser than the background. And the linear field, were that to still exist, would have reached a value of 1.686. Okay? Now, we can repeat this calculation for a range of dark energy models. And as you might expect, you're going to get different answers because the background universe is expanding differently, right? So this is not saying that the perturbation itself just has the sort of universal value of the dark energy, that there's no dark energy perturbation here, just the background is different. So if you pick out the W of minus one curve, that's like a lambda CDM value, and on the right-hand side here, we've got this delta V, this capital delta V, which is this virialized density of the halo. In the left-hand panel, you've got the linear delta C, the value the linear field reaches. And I've written all of these in terms of omega M as a function of the time, because that turns out to be like a nice way of parameterizing these things. So if you ignore these two bottom panels, the first thing I want to draw your attention to is in the top left panel, you see that if you change dark energy model, the value of these curves are slightly different, right? But it's really only very slightly different. If you imagine we're at omega matter of 0.3, so you're looking here really, and the difference between, these are quite extreme things, like a W of minus 1.5, a W of minus 0.5, but the range of delta C these span is like 0.02, so it's like maybe 1% differences that you're looking at between these things. And it's less, and the differences in delta V, this other thing, are more extreme. So again, if we go up from 0.3 and we look here, well, that's kind of spanning about a factor of 100 there. So your first thought, I guess, might be that these delta C differences are really small, and who cares? Right? The dash is a fitting function I was coming up with to make this plot, which is what the bottom panels show, how good that fitting function is. because it's a kind of a pain to run this calculation. So I, so if you ever want to, you can use my fitting function to do this. Great. I'll just write those numbers on the board as well, just because they're kind of important. So 1.686, and delta V is, it's like 177.7. Actually, if you, you know, follow this calculation through and believe it exactly, this number is at 18 pi squared, which is like a nice number. Okay, great. So why do these, you know, I guess the next question is where do these numbers, why do these numbers matter in cosmology, and like how can we use them? Because we've gone from the, we've done this very sort of this toy calculation. So what's where are we going to get? So this delta collapse is used in analytical mass function calculations. So one example of these is the Prescher-Schechter formalism, which I'm going to talk about in a minute. But it also comes into these excursion set approaches to deriving the mass function. That's the how many halos of certain mass you expect there to be. And delta V, the number that's 177, is kind of used to inform halo finding algorithms. And because people think, well, this calculation is kind of like a toy calculation, 177.7 is roughly 200. So kind of roughly 200 is often used as a way of identifying halos in an n-body simulation. This also, so you find like overdense regions and you put a sphere around them until that sphere encloses 200 times the mean density. Another way is via this friends of friends method, which I'll talk about in a second. So just to talk about the first of those points, that is the mass function calculations. So one popular and very useful approach to calculating the mass function of dark matter halos is to say, well, let's assume that this linear density field exists for all time, even though we know it's going to go nonlinear. So we know the statistics of that field are Gaussian, and so if we imagine smoothing the density field with a particular filter, we'll know if we plot the densities up, they'll form some Gaussian distribution. And so let's equate all of that Gaussian that's passed this critical number, 1.686, with halos that correspond in some way to the filter we use to smooth the density field with. So the idea here is, so we smoothed it with a filter which contains some mass. We say, oh, well, that means that there's this much of the density is over 1.686, therefore this much of the density is in halos above that mass. And we can do this for a different, in this case, slightly larger mass. The Gaussian then that we make is slightly tighter, and there are fewer halos above that. And in this way, we can sort of have a pretty good guess at what the mass function of dark matter halos looks like. Now, it turns out if you follow this approach exactly as I've described with a Gaussian, you get an answer if you compare it to n-body simulations that's kind of roughly correct, but not correct in detail. And there are several extensions of this approach that work much better. And this kind of slightly obvious point, but maybe, I don't know, maybe I'm not going to say, I was going to say an obvious or a subtle point, so maybe I'll just say a point. So we've got this number 1.686 that we said before. I said before changes very slightly with cosmology, but it relates to tails of a distribution, right? And this distribution, like if you're, you know, small changes in where you draw this when you get down into the tails of some Gaussian actually make quite large differences. So if your initial thought when you heard that this number delta C varies very slightly with cosmology, so this is the Einstein de Sitter value for it. But if you change to a standard lambda CDM, it's 1.676. Your first thought might be that doesn't really matter very much, but actually it matters a little bit. And certainly, if we're thinking about 1% accuracy in terms of these observables, this is the type of thing that may matter, right? The other thing to note is that this argument I gave you for a density field being smoothed is sort of independent of the cosmology. All it depends on is the power spectrum, because if you take some density field that's given by some power spectrum, and then you smooth it with some filter, the only thing that matters there is the shape of the power spectrum, and it doesn't matter on the cosmology otherwise. And this is why people talk about like the universality of the mass function, because they say it should be a function of only the smoothing scale and the power spectrum, the underlying power spectrum. So can we test this all from simulations? So again, I'm going to show you something in physical space here, and just we're going to watch a simulation happen. And you can see that nothing that's kind of going on here really looks very obviously like a spherical top hat collapse. Right? You have all sorts of sort of train wreckages going on. And and again, here I'm showing you the density field around some massive peak. So if you try to assign a mass to this, it's sort of something like 10 to the 15 solar masses. But you'll note that like it's definitely not spherical. And were you to, you know, you sort of, your eyes sort of say, oh, that's kind of like, that's it, right? But if you were to ask to exactly to define the halo, it's kind of like a difficult problem to do in detail. There are plenty of like these sub-halos and infalling objects. It's not spherical, so if you attempted to draw some spherical boundary around it, you might like get some less populated region here and miss out some part there. So what you're left with really in the simulation is a particle distribution. So there's this spherical overdensity SO method of finding halos, which is exactly what I was talking about there. You put down a sphere and count particles, but say this was what we've done here, you're missing kind of something that looks like it should be really part of that halo. Here, you know, that looks more spherical, so maybe it's better there, but then there are other things. These two objects, is that one thing? Is it two things? You know, how do you define halos like this? The other thing you can do is this friends of friends method where you link close particles. So this is just an example of what the friends of friends thing would pick out with a linking length of 0.15 times the mean interparticle separation. So you get this, but if we change the linking length, suddenly we start like absorbing new things into our structure. You know, is this blob that appears as a separate thing here, is it really part of that halo? Is that even a question that's like a well-defined question? I don't know, right? And here's a different linking length, and you can see as you go, you know, the masses of everything kind of generally go up as you increase the linking length, but like stuff gets cobbled together. And so if we wanted to say test whether these tiny deviations in these, or this tiny deviation in delta C and these other deviations are relevant, I would suggest that if we try and do it via the halo distribution, we're going to pretty quickly run into difficulties that are associated with exactly how one should define a halo, right? So if I were to, example, run a load of different simulations and then pick out the halos, at the end, I can imagine, you know, writing the paper and at the end saying, oh, we don't really know whether, if we'd chosen a slightly different definition of what a halo was, we'd have got a slightly different answer, right? Yeah?
Well, so up to this point, you've only talked about using one number to characterize whether particles should be inside a halo or not. And so you're only looking at different ways of talking about densities.
Mm-hmm.
But some people might argue that what would define whether a particle should be in a halo or not might be related to whether that particle is virilized or not.
Right, okay, sure. Yeah, I think that's probably true. And this is something I haven't really thought about like as much as so yeah, if there are like, I mean, I know, for example, you can sort of decide after, like, you know, you do a friends of friends and then you sort of identify peaks in the friends of friends distribution, and then you can start trying to say particle by particle whether or not that particle should be considered to be bound to a halo. So I maybe we should talk about this afterwards, because this is might be relevant to things. So so what I'm going to suggest to test this is something different. So here's a table from a paper. So what I did here was say I'm going to run n-body simulations, and I'm not going to identify halos in them. I'm just going to try and interpret the density fields in those simulations and see if the interpretation, if I can use these spherical collapse numbers in the interpretation. So to try and make these things as similar as possible, what I've done is I've fixed them all to have exactly the same power spectrum, right, and exactly the same sigma 8. So we're going to look, just concerned about these things at redshift 0, and I've fixed artificially the sigma 8 to all of these things to be the same, and the power spectrum to be the same. These are models where we've got a lambda CDM. We also have an Einstein de Sitter model, an open universe, and then several different dark energy models, which are all parameterized by that time-varying dark energy equation of state there. So they've all at redshift zero, the linear field, where that still exists, has all reached the same point. But they've all reached it by different means, right? So some of the starting amplitudes of perturbations in all of these simulations would have been slightly different if they all started at the same redshift. So just to sort of illustrate what's going on here, here's the two linear power spectra that are evolving with time, and I've basically fixed their initial amplitude such that by redshift zero, they line up exactly. Okay? So one thing to bear in mind at this stage is that if your thought was that the nonlinear matter power spectrum should just be a function of the linear power spectrum, then these models will have the same nonlinear power spectrum, right? So if you believe that P nonlinear is some function P linear, then these must have the same spectrum, right? And this is, for example, in a lot of perturbation theory approaches, this turns out to be the case, right? So here's just an example of what's going on with the growth factors. These are just the growth factors relative to lambda CDM and the growth factor versus A, all by A of 1. These are all the same, but they all kind of got here by slightly different methods, right? So I guess the question is, does the nonlinear spectrum know about this? And here, oh yeah, as well, I'm just showing the different spherical collapse parameters. Again, as a function of omega matter, here we've got delta C, the 1.686 number on the left-hand panel, and delta V here. And these are for the different models that are considered. If anyone, this one's funny, right? So you get like a prize if you can tell me why that's doing that. Okay. So again, you just see that, again, the span at redshift, at omega matter of 0.3, where most of these simulations are, these things span kind of a small range of this delta C parameter, and again, like a sort of larger range of the virialized density parameter.
I was going to add that about the delta V. So is most of the delta V variation in a given model just due to the ratio of the density of the universe at maximum expansion to virialization?
Yeah, I think it's mainly that the universe is like less dense when this thing has collapsed, right? Yeah.
Which model is doing the funny thing?
It's this one here with WA. Yeah, so W naught is minus 0.7 and WA is minus 1.5. Okay. So the first thing, I've run these simulations, and now we can look at the density fields at redshift zero. So here's the lambda CDM simulation, and this is 200 by 200 megaparsecs. And now we look at the Einstein de Sitter simulation, and perhaps surprisingly to some of you, but perhaps unsurprisingly to others of you, these things are very difficult to distinguish, right? So I've got, the lambda CDM, Einstein de Sitter, and the open model. And, you know, maybe you're surprised about this because you think, well, lambda CDM has a cosmological constant and that universe like is accelerating, and Einstein de Sitter is decelerating, and the open model is decelerating more slowly. Because I fixed the linear power spectrum to be identical, on these very large scales, these all look the same, right? And you might be able to, if you look very closely, look at small differences in the way the halos are, right? So here's a zoom in on a halo in these simulations. So you've got several different models, the open, the Einstein de Sitter, and then different dark energy ones. And again, you can look at the halo, and it's kind of difficult for your eye to pick out many differences between these things, I think. So you might be able to convince yourself that the open model looks slightly denser compared to the Einstein de Sitter. So these are the two that differ the most from one another. But all of the others, I think you'd be quite hard-pressed to visually start identifying differences in these lower panels. That is despite the very different cosmological parameters and the different growth factors that all of these models have had to reach to get to the same point at redshift zero. Now, the next thing we can do is measure the power spectrum. And here we can see that things are actually different, right? So I'm just showing the matter. In the top panel, I'm showing the matter power spectrum. In each case, I've taken a ratio. I've taken measured the power spectrum in each simulation and ratioed it to the lambda CDM case. And so... the top panel is real space, that's the real space power spectrum, and this is just a zoom in on this part of the plot here. And in the lower panel, I'm showing the redshift space results for the monopole and redshift space. So we note the kind of thing that maybe our eyes told us before, that at very large scales, these modes here, all of these simulations agree, which is good, and sort of that's we match the linear power spectrum, so one should expect that. But then you see that once you get to about K of say 0.2, these things start to diverge from one another. And particularly the open model up here, you're getting a lot more power, 60% more power around K of 10. And you know there are other differences that sort of are in this arc here. In redshift space, at these large scales, all the models mostly agree, but they disagree slightly because the Kaiser effect is slightly different in each of these things. And that's particularly true of the Einstein de Sitter model, where there's a much more extreme Kaiser compression on those large scales. So these things are different. So clearly, if your thought was that the nonlinear power spectrum should always be a function of the linear power spectrum at that redshift, you're not right. I mean, this is proof that that's not a correct thing to think, right? The error bars here are from three different realizations for each simulation. You can see that there's very little scatter compared to the differences in the curves from realization to realization. So the question I want to now sort of come to ask is, can we somehow understand these differences using the spherical collapse model that we talked about?
So just to make sure I understand, so you fix these to have the same linear theory power spectrum today.
Yeah.
But at the time that most of those halos were being formed, each model had a different linear theory.
Absolutely, spectrum. Yeah.
I'm not sure what my question is. So that, is that really what we're seeing here on this?
I think that's definitely one way to think about it. Yeah, absolutely. It's that the power spectrum does care about what happened in the past, you know, which is kind of obvious. Okay. I think this is, the way I'm going to sort of suggest to you that we can understand these differences is looking at something called the Halo model. And this is some analytical model that uses the properties of halos, and you can use it to have a guess at what the power spectrum should look like. So here's the power in these kind of delta units. You break the nonlinear power up into a two halo term that accounts for the clustering between halos, and then a one halo term that accounts for the clustering that arises from within halos. So this is kind of like the two halo term is sort of like the large scale, so that's pretty much linear. So we might expect that term will be the same for all of these different cosmologies that I've shown you. And then the small scales is given by what the halo properties are doing, right? And the halo properties, if you work it out what that should be, you get this down here, which I'll break down on the next slide. So that's the same integral just at the top of this thing. So this is how you calculate the one halo power. It's an integral over the halo mass. So we're sort of summing up the properties of halos of all sorts of different masses. Let's see, okay. So we've got the mass function, which I've got here. So that tells you how many halos of a certain mass there are in a cosmology. We have this relation between the peak height, which is this new parameter, and the actual halo mass, which is given by, it depends. So the mass functions I'm going to be interested in are parameterized in terms of this new variable, right? So an example of a mass function that's parameterized like that is sort of the classic Prescher-Schecter one is. But for example, Tinker is not parameterized in terms of nu, it's parameterized in terms of sigma directly, right? So in the Tinker mass function, this delta C has been annihilated from that. There's a halo density profile, which I'm going to take to be the NFW profile. We need to truncate that at some sort of radius in this calculation. So there's a virial radius. And again, in here appears or not that delta V. You sort of have a you know, you've got choices over all of these ingredients. And you also need to have some concentration relation for the halos. And once again, there are concentration relations that simply depend on the halo mass, right? So an example of that is like the Duffy concentration relation, which is simply a concentration as a function of mass and redshift, right? And so, for example, if you take, say, the Tinker mass function, which is just a function of sigma m, that's the variance in the density field on smoothed on scales according to m, all of these different simulations have exactly the same sigma m, right? Because they have exactly the same linear power spectrum and linear density field. So if you ignore the dependence in delta C, then the mass function for all of these things is exactly the same, right? If you believe that type of mass function. Again, if you say, well, the halos were identified with a 200 times spherical overdensity finder, that number is 200. So the virial radius is just a function of the mass, which is identical. So the virial radius is the same for each halo. Say you take a concentration mass relation where the concentration is simply a function of mass, then the concentration is the same, right? So with those choices of ingredients, the halo model is going to predict exactly the same nonlinear power spectrum for each of these models, which is clearly false from what I showed you before, right? I'm going to suggest some different choices of ingredients, which I use. So for example, I use a concentration mass relation from a 2001 paper, Bullock 2001, which is very old, but it does have this kind of neat property that the halo concentration depends on the formation history of the halo. So it allows you to define a collapse redshift for the halo, and it says that the halo's concentration depends on that, and that depends on the past, so it has this hysteresis within it. Yeah.
How different did the mass function look for all the simulations that you showed?
So again, I did calculate these at one stage, but I ran into this kind of issue that, like, at the end of the day, there were small differences, and I didn't know whether I could attribute those differences to the halo finder. Like, was it that the halo was just, you know, on average, a halo was slightly bigger because it, in some cosmology, it added an extra blob to it, or not? They look very similar. Yeah. Very very similar, but subtly different. And then it's trying, you know. My first thought was, like, how did I then interpret those subtle differences? And it might be better using what either you or Phil was talking about earlier, or about the some perhaps better way of finding halos, because I was using friends of friends basically to do it, which is probably the worst thing you could do. Anyway, so I use a mass function that's parameterized in terms of this new parameter, where I keep the cosmology dependence of delta C. I keep the spherical collapse values for delta V in the equations, and I use this concentration relation that's a function of the formation time. Yeah.
In some contexts, the dependence of a halo's concentration on its formation history is called assembly bias.
Right.
Have you looked into this assembly bias literature to see whether there's any kind of connection between other things that people have done?
This approach definitely, I don't know about the assembly, like, in terms of actually measurements of assembly bias. But in terms of, you know, in the like glory days of cosmology, like in 2001 when these people were doing this kind of thing, people were really concerned about whether the universe was like an Einstein de Sitter universe or an open universe. And this type of approach where you somehow assign a formation time to a halo works pretty well in those cases when the concentration of the same object is quite different in these different models. But the sort of more modern trend is for people to run very high resolution simulations of one single cosmology, and then often the result is then parameterized as just some function of mass, right? Which is also a useful exercise. I'm not saying that's not a useful exercise, but, like, you know, for example, like a halo, it can't really know about the redshift of the universe. It's just not, you know, the halo doesn't care what redshift it's at. Its properties must be defined by, like, when it was formed, you know, when it's formed and stuff like this.
And sorry, do you have an analytic expression for the formation time?
You can write it down. If you look at this paper by the Bullock et al. Paper has this prescription for calculating the formation redshift, and it depends. Basically, it's when it's slightly bizarre in that it's when a halo has accreted some fraction of its mass in the past. And then there's some sort of pressure sector type arguments to calculate when that should be. But the fraction of mass that's that has to have collected to qualify as the formation redshift is 1%, which is really weird because, like, you can't think, like, the halo can't possibly care really about, like, when it was 1% of its present size. So something funny is going on there. But nevertheless, this is the prescription that, if you interpret the prescription literally, then that's what you'd get. Okay, so we've seen this before, right? This is exactly the same simulation plot I showed you, redshift space, real space, all the different power spectra. And now if we use this halo model to try and make the same curves. So again, we take the we run the Hailer model, we include the cosmology dependence of all of these spherical model parameters, and then divide them all by the lambda CDM value. This is what we get, right? And I mean, I think this is like absolutely remarkable, right? So we've used this kind of pretty ropey model of halo formation, and of the matter power spectrum, and nevertheless, so you know, the first thing you notice is that all of these curves, the solid lines, are like ordered correctly. So it's not correct in detail for the open model, or really for the Einstein de Sitter model, but at least like the ordering of the curves is correct, right? And B, particularly for the dark energy models, when you zoom in, the match here is very nearly perfect, right? And this gets particularly the scale at which these things start departing from being equal to one another is matched very beautifully. And you know, if you think, well, I care to 1% of KF5, I mean, this is accurate to 1% of KF5. I mean, this is the accuracy that Euclid requires for the matter power spectrum, right? If, for example, you compare what HaloFit would give you for these models, HaloFit predicts these things, which are wrong at the, well, wrong at the 5% level, but like grossly wrong in this case, right? Like the trend is wrong, like the wave number at which the departure start is wrong. But this completely parameter-free model, all we've done is run spherical collapse calculations and then do a Halo model calculation, has got the answer bang on for the dark energy models. And I mean, it's less good here and for the open model, but hopefully you're not worried about that too much.
So this is with the Bullock et al. Formation redshift versus mass?
It's, yeah, using the Bullock et al. Collapse prescription and also including these numbers. So including, for example, in the mass function, including that the barrier changes slightly, right? I'll show you here, right? So yeah, the effect of changing delta C, these small changes in delta C, is but fixing the concentration mass relation to be the same and delta V to be the same, it is very slight, right? But it's what gets you the accuracy at this kind of departure from these things being equal to one another. If you then also include the delta V dependence, then this is what you get. So that sort of nails around K of one, and then it's the concentration mass hysteresis there that really gets you further out. So yeah, I mean, in order of importance, you'd probably, well, these two are probably as important as one another, and then that's slightly important. But it's kind of, if you, for example, don't include this, don't include the delta C change, then it's screwed up here.
Oh, it is.
So it really is. So it does matter, which is kind of surprising. Right. So just the last thing I'll talk about is instead, so it's all very well, you know, getting the answers for these dark energy models, which I thought was quite nice, but my next thought was, can we apply this to maybe some modified gravity models? So this is just a toy example of a model that exhibits something called Van Stein screening here. So these equations up here give you the, they're the sub-horizon quasi-static evolution of the time-time metric potential and the space-space metric potential here. So if there was no modified gravity, there'd be none of these, neither of these terms, and these things are equal to one another. But in this particular model, these potentials get contributions from gradients in this new thing, phi, and this new thing, phi, has its own equation of motion, which is this kind of fairly complicated-looking thing down here. So what you'll notice about the fairly complicated-looking phi equation of motion is it's got these kind of linear parts here. That term is linear in phi. This term is quadratic in phi. So if we linearize these things, we can just completely get rid of this, and you get this equation, which governs the time-time potential. The time-time potential is that accelerates non-relativistic particles, and the normal one would not have this 1 over 3 beta term. So it's this 1 over 3 beta term that gives you modified gravity on large scales. So it gives you a scale-independent enhancement, in this case, of the gravitational force on large scales, right? And beta is just some function of time. Now, clearly, we know that G is G, so you need to have some screening mechanism to restore gravity to the standard on solar system scales and in galaxies and places where gravity is well measured. And that's where this nonlinear term comes in here. So if you, I mean, it's not particularly obvious, but looking at this, but you can figure out what the effect of this term is. And what it is it does is to screen the modification in regions of high density. So in high density regions, G returns to G and isn't enhanced by this 1 over 3 beta part. So again, somewhat miraculously in this model, you can solve for the scalar field profile in a region of spherical symmetry exactly. And so that's what's done here. So this is the full answer for d phi by dr. So that's the gradient of the scalar, the radial gradient of the scalar field in a spherical perturbation. And if you think about it, it's d phi by dr is just like the extra force bit. So it's it has this kind of weird looking form where it depends on this r star thing, which is called the Van Stein radius, right? And for scales that are, for r values that are much below the Van Stein radius, gravity is restored to the normal. And for scales that are above the Van Stein radius, you get the enhanced by 1 over 3 beta part here. So that's all you need to know about Van Stein screening. So people have run simulations for these modified gravity models. And here's just an example of three of them. So we have three different strengths, the red being the most strong one. So the dashed lines, again, this is the power spectrum. Sorry, so this is K power, and this is a ratio to the lambda CDM model in this case. So we have these horizontal lines, the linear expectation for the enhancement. And then the solid lines are that measured in simulation. So at large scales, you see that kind of pretty much agrees with the linear expectation. These kind of quasi-linear scales or kind of non-linear scales, you get a boost in each case beyond the linear expectation. And that's quite understandable in terms of the fact that these models are producing, because the linear field is enhanced, they're producing more halos. So there's even more power than just the sigma rate enhancement on these intermediate scales. But on these smaller scales, this kind of screening mechanism is coming into effect, and these things are all, the enhancement of power is dropping off again. Now, the results I showed you before were not for simulations where we had different linear power spectra. So I can show you a version of this plot again, but where we've taken, in each case, their ratio to a lambda CDM model, which has been grown so as to have exactly the same linear spectrum. So in this case, the modified gravity model looks, instead of like a boost in power, it's a drop in power compared to the lambda CDM model with the same sigma rate. So we've got the strong one, the medium one, and the weak one. And then the solid line, again, is a Halley model prediction for these differences. And you can see that this is a Halley model prediction where the calculation of the parameters I've done has been done using a linear approximation for the modified gravity. So I've linearized the modified gravity equations and recalculated these things. And you can see that even in doing that, the answers are still not bad, right? So we sort of get kind of general trends correct, even though this is some kind of crazy modified gravity theory. But perhaps the most remarkable thing is that if we can do a spherical collapse calculation, but including the screening mechanism, which we can do in this case quite nicely because the screening mechanism, there's an exact solution for it in spherical symmetry, we get this answer, right? So as soon as you add screening into the calculation, the residual, as predicted by the Halley model for the ratio of the power spectrum to the lambda CDM case, is, again, pretty accurate. Okay? And that's all I have. So thank you for listening. I guess I'll just leave those up. Oh yeah, the one thing I should honestly point out is that baryonic physics is the one big elephant in the room for weak gravitational lensing on these small scales. So I haven't talked about that at all. But I would say that any successful approach to modeling the nonlinear spectrum probably should start from spectra in the absence of baryons that are accurate. And so I suggest this as a method that you can get 1% accuracy in the matter power spectrum so that you can then build baryon models on top of that. So thanks for listening.
Further question? Have you thought about the things like the bispectrum with this kind of model?
No, but that would be a good thing to think about, I think. I mean, there are like several different avenues. I mean, I think particularly kind of interesting is this idea that you could use this to make very accurate predictions of the nonlinear spectrum for modified gravity models. That was like the first sort of application I thought of. But certainly these higher order statistics, and would be definitely something to think about. And another thing I think would be to actually check whether these differences make any difference at the level of halos, which I was saying I hadn't done because it's difficult to know what a halo is. But I think I probably haven't thought carefully enough about that. So I'd be kind of interested in that.
Yeah, if you could get realistic models for things like the three-point function and the schemas, that
would be... Right. Okay, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's certainly like the type of approach. So the method I worked on previously, this HM code, that's kind of almost exactly what we did. We sort of said, well, baryons are unlikely to affect the large-scale distribution of halos with respect to one another, but they will affect the internal structure. So we did something like change the concentration and internal structure properties of halos. And then you can get a kind of pretty broad brush of a kind of idea of what the effect on the matter power spectrum of baryons would be. The problem is there aren't like none of the hydrosims that people have done. They give you great ideas of the type of effects that are possible with baryonic feedback physics, but you'd never claim they were accurate to a percent. And whether they ever will be or not is a different, you know, that sounds like a thing that. Yeah, so that, I mean, that's the hope that with we grab, you know, if you look at the Euclid white paper, they claim that they will be able to measure this matter power spectrum to 1% to K of 5, and so you need to know the matter power spectrum to that accuracy, and baryonic feedback has a huge impact on the power spectrum at that level. So I mean, this is really exciting if you care about baryonic feedback, right? Because it turns Euclid into a survey that you could actually, you might learn things about AGN from, right? Whereas, you know, it's not exciting for the people who care about dark energy, you know, because this is a contaminant for them.
But there's a scale dependence on your feedback, so.
Right. Right. I think it's true though that the number I think that's now dark energy equation of state measured to 2% requires the matter power spectrum to be sort of perfectly known to K of 5. Like that's.
Modes, I mean, you need those extra modes at small scales.
Yeah. So you certainly. I mean, like I think what will happen in reality will be that these baryonic feedback models are marginalized over, and the ignorance of that is taken into account, and consequently the dark energy constraints will be degraded. But we'll learn things about, you know, astrophysics from